नाशाय दुष्कृतम् धर्म संस्थापनार्थाय संभवामि युगे युगे. मीन्स कृष्ण डिसेंड्स इनटू दिस वर्ल्ड टू प्रोटेक्ट द डिवोटीज एंड टू पनिश द मिस्क्रिएंट्स एंड आल्सो टू एस्टैब्लिश धर्म. सो प्रोटेक्टिंग द डिवोटीज इज अ प्राइम रीजन एंड पनिशिंग द डीमंस इज अ सेकेंडरी रीजन. So there are multiple reasons for Krishna's descent as an avatara in this world, but there is hierarchy amongst those reasons. So this we need to understand that whenever the Lord descends in some form, there are some internal reasons, confidential reasons, and there are some external reasons which are like very much relevant to common people. However, although there is gradation between these reasons, we should not prematurely or immaturely think that the external reasons are not very important, the internal reasons and confidential reasons are more important. We should not think like that. Yes, definitely confidential reasons or internal reasons are more important, but from our perspective, oftentimes external reasons of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's descent are more relatable than the internal reasons of Lord Chaitanya's appearance. So to summarize, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu descends into this world for establishing Yuga Dharma. This is one of the prominent external reasons. That is Nam Sankirtan. And in that way, to give prema to all the living entities in this world. And the internal reason or confidential reason is to experience the emotions of Srimati Radharani. So that is confidential reason. Yes, this is higher and the previous one is lower, but we can relate with the lower thing more than the higher thing. So how Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is experiencing the emotions of Srimati Radharani is very esoteric and beyond the conception of an average practitioner, a struggling sadhaka. But we need to understand as much as it is revealed to us by the acharyas. But the external reason is very much relevant for us because Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu gives nama and prema to us. That is the external reason which is very much in suiting the situation of the conditioned souls. This fourth chapter is a little esoteric, but still for our understanding, Kaviraj, as explained by Kaviraj Goswami, as explained by Srila Prabhupada, we need to understand what exactly Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is doing in his incarnation. He has accepted the mode of Srimati Radharani. So Kaviraj Goswami begins this chapter describing the external and internal reasons for Krishna's appearance first. Kaviraj Goswami says that Lord Krishna descends into this world to remove the burden of earth. And that is one of the reasons of Lord Krishna's appearance. And also Krishna incarnates in this world, and whenever Krishna incarnates, all his other incarnations are also present within his body. Because Krishna is Purna Bhagavan. Just like there is full moon, Purnami day, you can see full moon. Within that full moon, all the phases of moon are present. So there is a moon which is partially visible on a, say, Saptami day, on Ashtami day, on Panchami day, on Ekadashi day. But on Purnami day, you can see complete moon. Similarly, Krishna is like that complete moon, Purana Bhagavan, and all the other incarnations of Krishna are compared to moon, which is not completely revealing its full glory. So on Saptami moon, you will only see moon partially, not fully. Similarly, in certain incarnations of Krishna, Krishna does not exhibit all his qualities, but in Krishna's incarnation, Krishna exhibits all his qualities. So when Krishna descends, all the incarnations are already there within his body. So thus, Krishna is Purna Bhagavan, and that Purna Bhagavan descends into this world for multiple reasons. The external reason is to establish dharma and to take away the burden of earth by killing the demons. And Krishna need not personally kill these demons. These demons can be killed by Krishna's expansions also. But why Purna Bhagavan has to come? If Vasudeva, Sankarsana, Pradyumna, Aniruddha, Vishnu or Vamana or Narasimha, so these expansions of Krishna can do the needful, why Krishna has to come personally to kill all these demons? Because Krishna has many more things also could perform apart from the demons. Hare Krishna, am I audible? Okay. So the internal reasons for Krishna's descent are prema rasa aswadana, second raga marga bhakti pracharana. Prema rasa aswadana means Krishna descends to understand, to experience the sweet essence of all rasas of prema. And raga marga bhakti pracharana, and to also propagate bhakti, raga bhakti means spontaneous loving devotion unto Krishna in this whole world. So these are the internal reasons for Krishna's descent. So just as Krishna has his internal reasons and external reasons, confidential reasons and normal conventional reasons for his descent, similarly Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu also has his reasons for his descent. So Kaviraj Goswami in his Mangalacharan to this Chaitanya Charitamrita, he writes 14 verses. In the 5th and 6th shlokas of this Mangalacharan, means the first 14 verses of the first chapter of Chaitanya Charitamrita's Mangalacharan, in that 5th and 6th verses describe the confidential reasons for Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's appearance. Before describing the confidential reasons for Lord Chaitanya's appearance, Kaviraj Goswami, in that 5th verse, he describes Gaura Tattva. What is the Tattva of Lord Gauranga Mahaprabhu? He says, Radha Krishna Pranaya Vikriter Haladini Shakti Rasna Ekatmana Vapi Bhuvipura Deha Bhedam Gatautau Chaitanyakhyam Prakata Madhuna Tadvayam Chaityamaptam Radha Bhavadyutti Sivalitam Naomi Krishna Swarupam. Radha Krishna Pranaya Vikritir Haladini Shakti Rasmat means all the loving affairs between Radha and Krishna are the transcendental manifestations of the Lord's pleasure potency. Radha Krishna Pranaya means the loving affairs between Radha and Krishna are Vikritir Haladini Shakti Rasmat. They are the transformation of Krishna's Haladini Shakti, means internal pleasure potency of Krishna. And ekatmana vapi bhuvipura deha bhedau gatautau. Ekatmana, this Radha and Krishna are ekatma, so they are like one. So you can see Radha and Krishna, they are one. To my left side you can see Srimati Radharani and Vrindavan Bihari, they are one, but they have manifested themselves into two forms. Ekatmana vapi bhuvipura Deha Bhedau. So they manifested in two bodies, two forms, as a male, as a female, as Radha and as Krishna. They separated themselves eternally as two personalities. And again they have become one in the form of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Chaitanyakhyam Prakata Madhuna means in the form of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, this Radha and Krishna again became one. Tadvayam cha ekamaptam. Although they are two, they have become one again. How did this happen? First, one personality, Krishna, they are ekatma, but they have become two. And later again, they have become one in the form of Lord Chaitanya. How did this happen? Radha bhavadyuti subalitam naomi Krishna swarupam. Radha bhava means the emotion of Srimati Radharani. Dyuti means the complexion of Srimati Radharani. Radha bhavadyuti subalitam naomi Krishna swarupam. That Supreme Lord Krishna has accepted the emotion and complexion, mood and color of Srimati Radharani and became Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Radharani and Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu are in same color. So they both are golden, in golden complexion. So Krishna is blackish. So Krishna has accepted the complexion of Radharani. So he has become like Lord Chaitanya. And Krishna did not only accept the complexion of Radharani, he also accepted the emotion of Radharani. What is Krishna's emotion? Who is Krishna? Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. He is Purna Bhagavan. He is the abode of all six opulences completely. So that thus Krishna is the Supreme Lord, the Supreme Controller, Ishvara. But Radharani has the bhava of a devotee of Krishna. She is a devotee. She is the topmost of all devotees of Krishna. So that emotion of a devotee, emotion of a servant of Krishna has been accepted by Krishna. So Radha Bhava and Radha Duty. So her emotion as being a servant of Krishna, as a devotee of Krishna, and her complexion, which is golden, both are taken by Krishna, and Krishna has become Lord Chaitanya. So this is how Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is the combined form of Radha and Krishna. So Kaviraj Goswami explains this verse further, saying that Radha Krishna Eka Atma Duyideha Dhari Anyonye Vilase Rasa Aswadanakari Si Duyi Eka Ebe Chaitanya Gosai Rasa Aswadite Dohe Haila Eka Thang. So Radha and Krishna Eka Atma, they are one. Duyideha Dhari, they have become two forms. Anyonya vilase rasa asvadana kari, to relish, to do asvadana of rasas, they have become two. Sei dui eka ebe chaitanya gosai, these two forms have become one as chaitanya gosai, to do rasa asvadana. So thus, Kaviraj Goswami describes that Radha and Krishna are one, but they have become two. And later, to elaborately explain this one beautiful sloka that is describing Gaura Tattva, this Kaviraj Goswami describes the position of Srimati Radharani, and he also describes the position of Krishna. So, who is Srimati Radharani? We need to understand first. It is beyond our conception to understand the position of Srimati Radharani, but we will try to meditate on those shlokas written by Kaviraj Goswami and try to make our feeble attempt to understand her position at least to a certain degree. So Radharani, who is Radharani in relation to Krishna's energies? Srimati Radhika is a transformation of love in the heart of Krishna. Pranaya Vikara, Krishna has love in his heart, the personification of that love, the transformation of her love, of that love in the form of a person is Srimati Radharani. She is the internal energy, Swarupa Shakti of Krishna. What is that specific Swarupa Shakti? Haladini Shakti. So Haladini Shakti means that Shakti, that energy that can give pleasure to Krishna, that can give Ananda to Krishna. Haladini means that energy of Krishna that can cause Halada. That is Srimati Radharani, Haladini Shakti. She is the personification of that Haladini Shakti. We'll go a little deeper into details. So Krishna has multiple energies, and Krishna's body is Sachidananda. And Krishna has energies which are three. So Krishna's spiritual energy has three aspects. Krishna has multiple energies. That is Antaranga Shakti, Bahiranga Shakti, Tatastha Shakti. Now we are speaking specifically about his Antaranga Shakti, the internal potency. The internal potency of Krishna, or the spiritual energy of Krishna, has three aspects. What is that? Sandhini, Samvit, and Haladini. Sandhini means the potency of eternal existence. Samvit means cognizance or knowledge potency. Haladini means bliss or pleasure potency. So these are the three energies of Krishna. Sandhini corresponds to Sat. Samvit corresponds to Chit. Haladini corresponds to Ananda. We say Krishna is Sachidananda, right? That Sachidananda actually corresponds to these three energies of Krishna. Sandhini, Samvit, Haladini. So Sandhini or the eternity potency is Sat. Then Samvit, the knowledge potency is Chit. Then Haladini, or bliss potency or pleasure potency is Ananda. Satchit, Ananda, Sandhini, Samvit, Haladini. So these three are, these two sets are similar to each other. So now we'll come to the Haladini potency. So Haladini potency is the Ananda, the pleasure potency of Krishna. And the essence of this Haladini potency is Prema, means love of God. And the essence of prema is bhava, means emotion towards Krishna. And the ultimate development or epitome of bhava is mahabhava, the extreme emotion of Srimati Radharani. And Srimati Radharani is the embodiment or personification of that mahabhava. Mahabhava swarupa Sri Radha Thakurani Sarvaguna Khani Krishna Kanta Shiromani. So Mahabhava means the deep, intense, loving emotion towards Krishna is represented in Srimati Radharani. She is the personification of that Mahabhava. So Srimati Radharani is the repository of all good qualities, Sarva Guna Khani. And Krishna Kanta Shiromani, the crest jewel of all consorts of Krishna. Krishna Kanta means consorts of Krishna. So her mind, her senses, her body are steeped in love for Krishna. So she is Krishna Prema Bhavita. And of all Kantas of Krishna, consorts of Krishna, she is the crest jewel. Krishna's consorts are of three categories. Number one, Lakshmi Gana. Number two, Mahishi Gana. Number three, this Gopi Gana. So Lakshmi Gana means the goddesses of fortune are Lakshmi Devis who are there in Vaikuntha. And Mahishi Gana means the queens of Krishna in Dwaraka Dham. And this Gopi Gana means the gopis in Vrindavan. So thus, Krishna's concepts are of three categories. Of all these three categories, this Gopi Gana, the gopis of Vrindavan are the topmost. And of all the gopis, Srimati Radharani is the topmost. Radharani is the is Lord Govinda's pleasure-giving potency. She is the enchantress of Govinda also. That's why she is described as Govindanandini Radha Govinda Mohini. So Govindanandini Radha, she is Govinda Mohini. She can give Ananda to Govinda and she can attract Govinda. Govinda Sarvasva, she is everything for Lord Govinda. Sarvakanta Shiromani, she is the crest jewel of all consorts of Krishna. So thus, Brihat Gautamiya Tantra describes that Srimati Radharani is Krishna Mayi. This beautiful shloka comes. Devi Krishna Mayi Proktam Radhika Paradevata Sarva Lakshmi Mayi Sarva Kantihi Sammohini Para Devi Krishna Mayi Proktam. Devi means she is the eternal beautiful goddess, resplendent and most beautiful goddess. She is the lovely abode of all sports of Krishna, Devi. Krishna Mayi means she is identical with Krishna. She embodies Krishna Prema. So Krishna Mayi, she is filled with Krishna. That's why she is called Krishna Mayi. So her inside and outside, everything is filled with Krishna. She sees Krishna wherever she glances. That's why she is called Krishnamayi. And Radhika, Devi Krishnamayi Prokta Radhika Paradevata. Radhika means she is the topmost worshipper of Krishna. She does the best aradhana. That's why she is called Radhika. Radhika is that personality who does the best aradhana of Krishna, trying to fulfill all the desires of Krishna. Anaya Radhito Nunam. No one can worship Krishna as much as Srimati Radharani does. Radhika Paradevata. Paradevata means she is the supreme goddess. She is the supreme protector of all. She is the supreme mother of entire universe. And Sarva Lakshmi Mayi. Sarva Lakshmi Mayi means she is the original source of all Lakshmis. Sarva Kanti Chiromani Para means she all beauty and all luster rest in her body. And all Lakshmis derive their beauty from her. Sammohini Para. Krishna enchants the entire world, but Radharani enchants Krishna also. So in this way, Srimati Radharani is described. And that Srimati Radharani and Krishna are one. Radha Purna Shakti Krishna Purna Shakti Man. Duyivastu Bhedanai Shastra Praman. So Radharani is Purna Shakti. She is energy and Krishna is Purna Shaktiman. He is the energetic person. Shakti and Shaktiman. So they are one. So without Shakti, there is no meaning to Shaktiman. Without Shaktiman, there is no existence for Shakti. The Shakti and Shaktiman are together. Duivastu Bhedanai Shastra Praman. Shastras are saying this. That they both are same. Radha Krishna Aichya Sada Eka Eswarupa Leela Rasa Aswadipe Dhare Duirupa. So they both are one. One Swarupa, but to do asvadana, to relish these nectarian mellows of different leelas and rasas, so they manifest in two forms. So this is the significance of the personality of Srimati Radharani. And later Kaviraj Goswami also describes how Krishna is Rasika Shekhara. So mainly Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, the confidential reason for Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's appearance is that Krishna wanted to experience these emotions of Srimati Radharani. Thus, Kaviraj Goswami elaborately describes the qualities of Srimati Radharani. And Krishna is so enchanted with these qualities, and Krishna wanted to manifest those qualities, wanted to imbibe those qualities and become a devotee. Here the Supreme Lord wants to become a devotee. So when God becomes a devotee, that is Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So Krishna is Rasika Shekhara, Krishna is the supreme enjoyer of all rasas, and that Rasika Shekhara became Radhika and accepted the emotions of Radharani. So thus Krishna became Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu by accepting the emotions and complexion of Radharani. Radhikara bhava murti prabhura antara sei bhave sukha dukha uthe nirantara. So Radhikara bhava murti, all the bhavas, all the emotions of Srimati Radhika are there in the heart of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's heart is a reflection of Srimati Radharani's emotions. Sei bhave sukha dukha uthe nirantara, because of those emotions is constantly feeling joy and distress both. He is feeling the distress of separation from Krishna. He is feeling the joy of meeting with Krishna. Always immersed in love for Krishna. Both are spiritual. This joy and so-called distress, both are ultimately spiritual bliss only. So this is how we need to understand that Srimati Radharani is the eternal consort of Krishna. She is the best of all devotees of Krishna. And the Supreme Lord Krishna was so enchanted with the emotion, with the devotion of Radharani, that he wanted to imbibe her spirit, and thus he took the form of Lord Chaitanya, accepting her emotions. And to go deeper into these details, basically Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is Krishna only. And Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is Krishna with the emotion of Radharani. We need to understand, how can I accept the emotions of another person and feel separation from myself? How can I miss someone? So Radharani is constantly experiencing the feelings of separation from Krishna, and Krishna, accepting the mood of Radharani, was absorbed in separation from Krishna, means from himself. How is this possible? Kaviraj Goswami very beautifully explains that unless we accept the confidential or inconceivable potencies of the Supreme Lord Krishna, we cannot understand Chaitanya Tattva. We should have faith, we should believe in that inconceivable potencies of Lord Krishna, then only we can understand Chaitanya Tattva. Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's Tattva is not very easy to understand. Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is Krishna himself, but he is in the mood of Srimati Radharani. So how can one person accept someone else's mood and feel separation from one's own self? But that is possible because we are speaking about the Supreme Lord Krishna. And to go deeper into details, to enumerate the reasons, there are three reasons for Krishna's descent as Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. These three are the confidential, internal, primary reasons for Krishna's descent as Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So the three reasons are explained in this beautiful shloka. That is the sixth shloka of Mangalacharan of Chaitanya Charitamrita. The shloka says that Shri Radhaya Pranaya Mahima Kidrisho Vanayaiva Svadhyo Yena Dhuta Madhuriva Kidrisho Vamadiyaha Saukhyam Chasya Madanu Bhavataha Kidrisham Veti Lobhat Tadbhavadhyah Samaja Nishachi Garbhasindhau Harindu Shri Radhaya Pranaya Mahima Kidrusho Vanaiva. The first line of this shloka describes, this is Adrila, first chapter, sixth shloka. And this also is repeated in the Adrila, fourth chapter, shloka number 230. So in this shloka, this Shri Radhaya Pranaya Mahima Kidrusho Vanaiva. The first reason for Krishna's descent as Lord Chaitanya is to understand the glory of Srimati Radharani's love. Shri Radhaya means Srimati Radharani's, Pranaya means love, Mahima means its greatness or glory. Kidrusho Vanaiva, what is the glory of Srimati Radharani's love? Krishna keeps wondering, It's Radharani's love. So what is that greatness? To understand the greatness of her love, Krishna descended. That is the first reason. We will elaborately discuss these three reasons in the next half an hour, but I'll just enumerate the reasons. The first reason for Krishna's descent as Lord Chaitanya is to understand the glory of Srimati Radharani's love. Second reason, Svadhyo yena adbhuta madhurima kidrusho vamadiyaham. The second reason is that Svadhyo yena adbhuta madhurima, Krishna has a desire to experience his own sweetness. Means, why Radharani is loving Krishna so much? Because Krishna is very sweet. All these wonderful qualities are very sweet. So the wonderful qualities of Krishna that Srimati Radharani relishes are not even known to Krishna also. Sugar is sweet. But the person who is eating that sugar can experience the sweetness of sugar. The sugar itself cannot know the sweetness. Similarly, Krishna is sweet, Madhura. But Radharani is experiencing all that sweetness. But Krishna is saying, what is there in me that is attracting Radharani so much that she is uncontrollably attracted to me eternally? Since time immemorial, she has been serving me. For the rest of eternity, she will surely serve me. What is making me so attractive to her? So Krishna wanted to understand his own sweetness. So that is second reason. First reason was, Krishna wanted to understand the greatness of Radharani's love. Second reason was, Krishna wanted to understand his own wonderful qualities that are appealing to Radharani. What is the third reason? Saukhyam chasya madanu bhavatah kidrisham veti lobhat. Saukhyam cha asya madanu bhavatah. When Radharani experiences the sweetness of Krishna, what is her relish? What is her happiness? While tasting Krishna's sweetness, how she is feeling that happiness? How only she feels that happiness? The happiness she feels when she realizes Krishna's sweetness is very intriguing to Krishna only. So I want to exactly have the similar experience as her while she is serving me, while she is tasting my sweetness. The second and third reasons may seem little similar. Definitely there is an overlap. But point is, to give an example, for example, you have made rasagulla. Rasagulla is sweet because of so many reasons. Like rasagulla is made from pure cow milk and you get use the best sugar. You cooked it at the right temperature and you soaked in sugar syrup in a very right manner. The sugar syrup is also made properly. Like that, there could be several reasons why rasagulla is sweet. Okay, rasagulla is so tasty. So that is the second reason. When I am eating rasagulla, what is my happiness? What is my ecstasy? Okay, that is the third reason. So second reason is, why Krishna is so sweet? Second reason, while experiencing this sweetness, what is Radharani's happiness? So like that, these two are this is the distinction between the second reason and third reason. To summarize, Lord Krishna appeared as Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu for three reasons. These three are the internal reasons or confidential reasons for Lord Chaitanya's appearance. Number one, Krishna wanted to understand the glory of Srimati Radharani's love. Number two, Krishna wanted to understand his own sweetness. Number three, Krishna wanted to experience what Radharani is experiencing while relishing his sweetness. Like that. So these are the three reasons. So because of these three confidential prime internal reasons, Krishna became Lord Chaitanya. How? Tadbhavadhyah samajanishachi garbhasindhu harindu. Tadbhavadhyah means Krishna has accepted the bhava of Radharani. Samajani shachi sindhu, shachi garbha sindhu means Krishna accepting the mood of Radharani entered the womb of Sachi Mata. Sachi Mata's womb is compared to an ocean, milk ocean. And Krishna is compared, Lord Chaitanya is compared to the moon that is coming out of the ocean. So, moon appeared from the ocean. Similarly, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu appeared from the womb of Sachi Devi. Tad bhavanyah samajani shachi garbha sindhu harinduhu. Garbha sindhu is ocean of womb, Hari Indu. Indu means moon of Lord Chaitanya, not Hari here. So these are the three reasons for Lord Chaitanya's appearance as the son of Sachimata. Internal reasons. Why? Because Krishna has these three unfulfilled desires to understand Radharani's greatness, to understand the greatness of Radharani's love, to experience, to understand his own sweetness, to understand why, what is the happiness of Lord Chaitanya, Lord, what is the happiness of Radharani while experiencing Krishna's sweetness. These are the three reasons. Let's elaborate them based on what Kaviraj Goswami has taught us. So, Kaviraj Goswami explains the first desire of Krishna to understand the greatness of Radharani's love. Shri Radhaya Pranaya Mahima. Now, in the spiritual world, Krishna started thinking, I am the prime cause of all rasas. I am Rasera Nidhan, Purnanandamaya. I am full of joy. And Chinmaya, Purna Tattva. I am filled with spiritual truth. But Radharani's love is so intriguing to me. So although I am filled with so much of joy and knowledge, but the qualities of Srimati Radharani's love are really enchanting me, attracting me. So Srimati Radharani's love is driving Krishna mad. And the strength of Radharani's love is unknown to even Krishna. And Srimati Radharani's love acts like a guru and teaches Krishna. And Krishna becomes a dancing student in Radharani's hands. So, and Srimati Radharani's love gives 10 million times more pleasure to Radharani than Krishna. For example, you are showing some love and affection to another person. With that love and with that affection, you are serving that person in various ways. He being the recipient of your services, recipient of your love and recipient of your affection, he should be very happy. But when you are showing love to that person, your happiness is 10 million times greater than that person's happiness. Similarly, when Radharani is loving Krishna, Krishna, the receiver of that love, feels that Radharani's pleasure is 10 million times greater than my pleasure. So I want to understand the greatness of her love. So it is full of contradictions. Radharani's love is full of contradictions. To go a little deeper into this subject matter, Radharani's love is expanded everywhere, yet still it continuously expands. Because Radharani's love is already unlimited, but it expands unlimitedly. There is no scope for expansion, but it still continues to expand. So love increases day by day. Now, how can some person show more love more than this? Krishna is wondering. But the next day, Radharani shows more love to Krishna. So like that, Radharani's love continuously expands. It has been expanding since time immemorial, and it will continue to expand for the rest of eternity. And nothing is greater than Radharani's love, but that love of Radharani is devoid of pride. When somebody is very great, one may feel proud. Srimati Radharani's love is very great, but Radharani has absolutely no tinge of pride. And nothing is purer than Radharani's love, but yet it has a lot of crookedness and some duplicitousness also. So it's a bit duplicitous sometimes. That's a part of loving pastimes which could be beyond the conception of an average struggling sadhaka. But to this degree, we can accept this description. So Radharani is the highest abode or ashraya of Krishna's love, and Krishna is the object or vishaya of that love. So Krishna is the object of love, Radharani is the ashraya, shelter of that love. So she is the abode of love. So Krishna prema is there, and Radharani is the abode of that prema. All love for Krishna is contained within Srimati Radharani. I only taste the bliss of vishaya. Krishna says that I am being the object of her love. Can I become the shelter of her love? So she loves me. She is the abode of love, she is the ashraya, and I am vishaya. She is the abode of love and the object of love. Now it seems that the abode of love has more happiness, 10 million times more happiness than the object of love. So can I have the same experience that she is having? When will that have? When this vishaya becomes ashraya, then I can experience the greatness of her love. If I should become ashraya, so let me taste her joy. So curious in this way, Krishna's desire blazed in his heart. So I want to understand the greatness of her love. I can understand only by becoming that love. So Krishna is very sweet, and Radharani is experiencing that sweetness. I should become the relisher of that sweetness. I cannot be just remaining as sweet and then experience my own sweetness. It's difficult. So like that. So that is the first reason for Lord Chaitanya's appearance. And second reason is Krishna's second desire. Krishna desired to taste his own sweetness. Madhya Adbhuta Madhurima. So Krishna's sweetness is so wonderful, and Krishna wanted to understand, how sweet am I? So here, Krishna, Kaviraj Goswami describes various aspects of Krishna Madhurya, how sweet Krishna is. Krishna is so wonderful. His sweetness is wonderful. It's infinite. It's full. No one can find the limit of Krishna's sweetness. Only Srimati Radharani, whose love is so pure like mirror, can taste it. For example, a beautiful person is there. A beautiful person is decorated with nice ornaments and flower garlands and other cosmetics. And already the person is beautiful, and the person is more beautiful with so many decorations. But without a mirror in front, one cannot actually understand how beautiful he is. How am I looking? Someone has to tell him. He himself cannot understand. He may be wearing the best suit, or if she is a girl, she may be wearing the best sari. So they may be in best costumes and best ornaments and best cosmetics. But unless there is a mirror in front, they cannot actually understand how beautiful they are looking. Similarly, Krishna is so sweet, but Srimati Radharani is like mirror. So only Radhika, whose love is so pure like mirror, can taste it. So Krishna is sweet, but that sweetness is actually reflected in the mirror of Srimati Radharani's love. Without Radharani's love, Krishna cannot understand how sweet he is. Just like without a mirror, a person cannot understand how beautiful he is or she is. Similarly, without Srimati Radharani, Krishna cannot understand how sweet he is. Because he is sweet, he cannot understand his own sweetness. He needs Radharani to show that. So many devotees are there who relish Krishna's sweetness to certain degrees. So they all reveal how beautiful and how great Krishna is. But Srimati Radharani loves Krishna to the maximum possible extent, and she is the greatest lover of Krishna, greatest devotee of Krishna. Thus, whatever Srimati Radharani is relishing is the best taste of Krishna. So Krishna is very sweet, and that sweetness is relished to the maximum possible extent by Srimati Radharani. Just like Krishna is beautiful. For example, a person is beautiful. How beautiful he is, if he has to know, he has to see in a clean mirror, in a very crystal clear mirror. If he just sees his face in a dirty mirror, his face is not totally reflected. Or if he sees his face in a mobile screen, so still a reflection is seen, but it's not very clear, it's a black screen. So a clear mirror has to be there. Just like to capture the beauty of a scenic spot, you need a very high definition camera. So if you take in a small webcam and then capture that scene, you cannot actually get the real thing out of it. Now we have a very beautiful screen. Now you have a webcam. Webcam is say 1 megapixel. So the picture cannot be transmitted properly. The video cannot be transmitted properly. And you have signal is very poor. You cannot transmit the video properly. So the object may be very great, but when the object is reflected in a proper mirror, then the greatness of the object is revealed nicely. So proper photographer, proper cameraman should be there to reveal the beauty of that object. Similarly, Krishna is beautiful. Krishna is sweet. But Srimati Radharani relishes that beauty, relishes that sweetness to the maximum possible extent. Her love is like a pure mirror that reflects Krishna's beauty to the best possible extent. So aspects of Krishna's madhurya are there. So Krishna is understanding. I want to understand what is my sweetness that Radharani is releasing. Just imagine the mirror has a consciousness, and the mirror is showing the reflection of so many people coming in front of it. So if the mirror has a consciousness, mirror will feel happy to reflect the image of a beautiful person than people who may not be looking so beautiful. So thus, here the mirror of Srimati Radharani's love is so pure that by reflecting Krishna's sweetness, Radharani is relishing that sweetness to the maximum possible extent. And seeing his beauty in a mirror, Krishna deliberates on a way to taste it and hankers for the position of Radharani. So Krishna sees his beauty in a mirror. Means Krishna is seeing how sweet he is in Srimati Radharani's happiness. And Krishna says, I also want that happiness. I want to know my sweetness. So if I become Radha, then I will understand my own sweetness. Krishna's Madhurya has this special characteristic. Kaviraj Goswami says, Krishna Madhurya Eka Swabhavika Bala Krishna Adi Naranari Karaye Chanchala. Krishna's Madhurya, Krishna's sweetness has a very natural strength. Swabhavika Bala. What is that? Krishna Adi Naranari Karaye Chanchala. Even men and women become uncontrollably attracted and restless seeing the beauty of Krishna. The thirst of one who drinks this beauty is never satisfied. And such a person consequently blasphemes Brahma also. That Brahma, you have created these eyes, and the eyes are constantly blinking, and we are unable to see Krishna's beauty. So what is the, you are supposed to give thousands of eyes so that we can relish Krishna's sweetness, but you have given only two eyes, and that too they are blinking. So they are covered by these eyelids. So you are not a very intelligent creator. Because of their intense eagerness to see Krishna's beauty, some devotees could even criticize Brahmaji also. Nityam nirikshamananam yadapidvara kaukasam navitrupyanti hidrishaha shriyo dhamanga manchutam. Nityam nirikshamananam. Although the Dwarakavasis are daily, regularly seeing Krishna's beauty, they are never satiated. Yadapi dvarakokasam navitrupyanti hidrishaha. They are not, their eyes are not satiated. They are not satisfied. So they wanted to see Krishna's beauty more and more. Like that, Kaviraj Goswami elaborately describes the glory of Krishna's sweetness in various ways. The sweetness and its strength are unprecedented. Simply by hearing about this sweetness, one's mind becomes unsteady. Mat guna shruti matrena mahi sarva guhashaye manogatir avichinna yatha gangam hasom budau. Just by hearing about the glory of Krishna's sweetness, Krishna's qualities, a devotee's mind is uncontrollably attracted towards Krishna. Just runs towards Krishna, just like Ganges gushes towards the ocean. So this is about Krishna's sweetness. And Krishna wanted to relish his own sweetness. We discussed two reasons, two confidential reasons for Lord Chaitanya's appearance. Number one, Krishna wanted to understand the greatness of Srimati Radharani's love. Number two, Krishna wanted to understand his own sweetness. Number three is Saukhyam Chasya Madanu Bhavataha. Krishna's third desire is he wanted to experience Srimati Radharani's happiness. While Radharani is relishing and tasting Krishna's sweetness, what is her happiness at her heart? So Krishna wanted to understand that. What is her ecstasy? Just like I gave this example, Krishna is sweet. Compare him with Rasgulla. Of course, Rasgulla is nowhere close to Krishna's sweetness, but just for our understanding, Rasgulla is so sweet, Krishna is very sweet. So why Rasgulla is sweet? Means why Krishna is sweet? That is the second reason. And the third reason is, when you are eating Rasgulla, what is your happiness? Means when Radharani is relishing the sweetness of Krishna, what is her happiness? Krishna wanted to actually experience that happiness. That's the third reason why Krishna descended as Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Saukhyam chasya madanu bhavataha. So, according to Rasa Siddhanta, this Rasa Siddhanta, or the conclusion of Melos, is very deep and can be known only by Lord Chaitanya's intimate companions like Swarup Damodar Goswami, Ramanand Rai. These are the very intimate associates of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So the gopis have their deep, intense emotion towards Krishna, which is called Rudhabhava. Rudhabhava, it is very pure, it is very spotless. Pure is Vishuddha, spotless is Nirmala. So the gopis' pure love for Krishna is like gold, because they have love for Krishna, they have no lust for Krishna. The relationship between a boy and girl is often seen as lust in this material world. But that lust is like iron, while love is like gold. So love is gold. So the gopis' love for Krishna has absolutely no desire for their own sense enjoyment. When they are coming in association with Krishna, when they are rendering so many services to Krishna, they are giving company to Krishna, they are actually desiring that Krishna should be very happy with our services. It's not that they are expecting something from Krishna. So, Atmendriya Priti Vancha Tare Vai Kam. If one desires one's own sense enjoyment, that is called lust. But if Krishnendriya Priti Ichha Dhare Premana, if one is desiring the happiness of Krishna's senses, that is called Prema. Kama and Prema are so different. They are poles apart. Kama is like iron and Prema is like gold. Kama is like bright sun and Prema is like bright sun and Kama is like dense darkness. So in this way, Kaviraj Goswami continues to describe. Atta yeva gopi ganera nahi kama gandha, Krishna sukha lagi matra, Krishna se sambandha. Atta yeva gopi ganera nahi kama gandha. In the pure loving affection of all the gopis, there is absolutely no trace of kama. Kama gandha is also not there. And Krishna sukha lagi matra, Krishna se sambandha. They are just desiring Krishna's happiness only. And Krishna se sambandha, they just desire Krishna's relationship only. They have absolutely no desire for their own happiness. Atma sukha dukhe gopira nahika vichar, Krishna sukha hetu cheshta mano vyavahar. Means atma sukha dukhe. So they are not bothered so much about their own happiness or their own distress. Gopika, gopira nahika vichar, they don't even consider, I am deriving happiness from this, I am deriving distress from this. Krishna sukha hetu cheshta mano vyavahar. Mano vyavahar means their thoughts, their actions. Cheshta is actions. Mano vyavahar means thoughts. Their thought process and their actions, they are completely for the purpose of Krishna's happiness. Krishna sukha hetu cheshta mano vyavahar. So in this way, Kaviraj Goswami describes that all the gopis are so dedicated to Krishna's service. When Krishna sees the gopis, sometimes the gopis decorate themselves so nicely just to give pleasure to Krishna. Because when Krishna sees the gopis beautifully decorated, his joy and his sweetness will increase. Then the gopis think, oh, Krishna has obtained so much of pleasure seeing me happy, seeing me beautiful. Thus, their beauty increases. When the gopis' beauty increases, Krishna's pleasure increases. When Krishna's pleasure increases, gopis' beauty increases even more. So like that, there is a transcendental, perpetual competition between Krishna's happiness and gopis' beauty. Krishna's beauty and gopis' happiness. Like that, there is constant competition between them, and no one knows defeat. Nobody is defeated. So there is absolutely no fault of lust in the gopis' relationship with Krishna. There is no trace of lust. Gopi preme Krishna kare Krishna madhurye rapushti madhurye badhaya prema haya mahatushti. So gopi preme kare Krishna madhurye rapushti. So by loving Krishna, the gopis are actually enhancing Krishna's sweetness. Krishna's sweetness is getting pushti. And madhurye badhaya prema haya mahatushti. When the sweetness of Krishna is increasing, then the satisfaction of the heart is also increasing. So in this way, the gopis love Krishna to the maximum possible extent. There is no other category of devotees who are greater than gopis in the entire cosmic manifestation, in the entire spiritual and material worlds. And we discussed it, the glory of gopis so much. And Srimati Radharani is the best of all gopis. So Srimati Radharani is the topmost gopika, and Krishna is attracted to all the gopis, and in specific, Krishna is having very special and unique attraction towards Srimati Radharani's love. And Krishna, and he, Krishna knows that by rendering service to me, Srimati Radharani is getting 10 million times more happiness than me. I get some happiness by receiving her service, but her happiness in serving me seems to be 10 million times greater than my own happiness. Her happiness in relishing my sweetness seems to be much, much greater than my own happiness. So I want her position. Krishna is hankering for her position. I want to be like Radharani. I want to experience the emotions of Radharani. So Krishna became very restless. Thus Krishna wanted to appear as Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Lord Chaitanya is seen as Krishna, but with the emotions of Srimati Radharani. So in this way, Kaviraj Goswami so beautifully explained the three internal reasons for Lord Chaitanya's appearance. And there are many more other esoteric aspects in this chapter. I summarized the gist of the chapter in just 1 hour. So we have seen that because of these three confidential reasons, Lord Krishna appeared as Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And the external reasons for Lord Chaitanya's appearance are to give Nama to all the people in this world. Nama means holy name, Krishna Nama, and Krishna Prem also. So in the Madhya Leela, 23rd chapter, first sloka, Kaviraj Goswami writes, Chiradadattam Nijagupta Vittam Swaprema Nama Amrutamatyudaraha Apamaram Yo Vitatara Gauraha Krishno Janebhyastam Aham Prapadye Chiradadattam. For a long time, the Supreme Lord Krishna has not bestowed one benediction on people. What is that? Nijagupta Vittam. That is the Krishna's own secret transcendental treasure. Nijagupta Vittam. Vitta is treasure. Gupta is very secret. Nijagupta Vittam, his own secret treasure. What is that? Swaprema Namamritam. Prema is love of God. Nama is name of God. So Krishna descended as Lord Chaitanya to give this Naam and Prem. Swaprema Nama Amritamatyudaraha Ati Udaraha. Krishna is so benevolent in his form as Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is the most benevolent expansion, incarnation of Krishna. He is bestowing this Nama and Prema. Swaprema Nama Amritamatyudaraha Apamaram Yo Vitatara Gauraha. And whom is he distributing to? Only Kshatriyas, only Brahmanas, only Sannyasis, only Brahmacharis, only Grihasthas? No distinctions. This is available even to the most fallen people also. Apamaram Yo Vitatara Gauraha. Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is distributing this Nama and Prema to Pamaras also, to the most degraded people also. Krishna Janebhyah Tamaham Prapadye. So I take shelter of the Gaura Krishna, the Gauranga Mahaprabhu, who has descended in the is Advaita Acharya and Haridas Thakur with loud appeal. Is called for the descent of Krishna. Krishna, people are getting so materialistic. There are so many external reasons for Lord Chaitanya's descent, and the internal reasons are these three. Number one, to understand the greatness of Radharani's love. Number two, to understand Krishna's own madhurya, sweetness. Number three, to actually experience the happiness that Radharani experiences while relishing Krishna's sweetness, while rendering service to Krishna. So, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, in his manifest pastimes of 48 years, sometimes he would focus on the external reasons for his descent, and sometimes he would focus on the internal reasons for his descent. External reasons for Lord Chaitanya's descent are to distribute holy name and to give Krishna Prem during his South India Yatra and during his Yatra to Vrindavan. Madhyalila has 25 chapters that Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has performed over 6 years. So these 6 years, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu predominantly did preaching. Basically, predominantly he was fulfilling the external reasons for his descent. But in the last 18 years of his sannyasa, so Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu took sannyasa at the age of 24 and he disappeared from this world at the age of 48. So 24 years he has been a sannyasi. In these 24 years, first 6 years, predominantly he was preaching Krishna consciousness. Predominantly he was distributing nama and prema. Means he is fulfilling the external reasons for his descent. And last 18 years, he was predominantly absorbing himself in the emotions of Srimati Radharani and feeling intense separation from Krishna. So Antyalila, the last 18 chapters of Antyalila, the last 18 years of Lord Chaitanya's pastimes are described in the Antyalila of Chaitanya Charitamrita. So in that Antyalila, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu experiences this Radharani's emotions. They are vividly described. Although there are many other pastimes how Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu dealt with devotees, these pastimes give us great teachings on Vaishnava Sadachar in the Antyalila. But Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is experiencing Radharani's emotions, fulfilling the confidential reasons for his descent. And whenever Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is too deeply absorbed in the emotions of Radharani, Ramanandarai and Swarup Damodar Goswami, they come and sing beautiful verses from Bhagavatam or Gita Govinda, J.J. Goswami's works. And pacify Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And they sing relevant verses that are matching his mood. So in this way, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu descended for various reasons. So thank you all very much. Shri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu ki jai. Shri Chaitanya Charitamrita ki jai. Chal Prabhupada ki jai. Hare Krishna.
Prabhu, thank you very much. It's a wonderful, wonderful session, Prabhu. It's amazing. Now we understood why Maharaj gave you Gauranga Darshan name. Literally we had Darshan of Lord Gauranga. Really we are very much thankful to you, Prabhu. Prabhu, I have a few questions. Some of them maybe looks very silly, but to understand the tattva of Lord Chaitanya Prabhu, just a couple of things. Prabhu,
how much time do we have, Prabhu? It's 12:34 now.
Up to you, Prabhu. Till whatever time you can.
You can ask Prabhu a question.
Okay, thank you, Prabhu. Prabhu, we understand that Krishna initially he was one. He expanded into Srimad Radharani, and then he merged back into Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Like qualities of both Radha and Krishna together. Is Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Prabhu, can we understand that Krishna before expanding into Radharani is Chaitanya Mahaprabhu only? Because he is expanding into Radha and Krishna and coming back as Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Can we understand that before expanding he was Chaitanya Mahaprabhu without the mood of Radharani? Is that understanding is right, Prabhu?
The shloka says, let's go by the shloka. The shloka is saying that Radha Krishna Pranaya Vikritir Hladini Shakti Rasmat Ekatmanav Api Bhuvi Pura. When did that one Krishna become two as Radha and Krishna? No one knows. Is there a T equal to zero where Radha and Krishna manifested? Where Krishna manifested as Radha and Krishna? We don't know. We can't trace it out. And if we can't trace out the t equal to 0, how can we trace out t equal to minus 1 or minus 2? So it's little beyond the conception, because beyond our understanding, or beyond what I have studied from Acharya's explanations. So I don't know whether we have to say like that or not. Unless it is clearly written or explained by Acharya, I can say. But It's since time immemorial they have Radha and Krishna are presented as two personalities. Since time immemorial means we don't know when is that equal to zero. So we don't know. It's equal to minus infinity. So before manifesting the Radha and Krishna, was there Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu? I'm not sure. I don't know. That's not mentioned. Should we think in these lines also? I'm not sure.
Thank you, Prabhu. Just clear now. Prabhu, one more question. You said Srimad Radharani is the best worshipper of Krishna among all. Yes, Prabhu. So, Prabhu, what kind of worship Srimad Radharani was? Because for us, for mundane senses, worship means like offering deity worship, what we do. But there, how can we perceive what kind of a worship Srimad Radharani was for? Is only like a serving Krishna in his Ras Lila or any other specific thing?
So many things. As far as Vaishnava literature reveals to us, whatever we have studied in that very little bit. So Srimad Radharani cooks for Krishna. She can make garlands. She worships Krishna in various ways. The details of the worship we are not, unless we read certain literatures, we may not be fully aware. But what we follow is what our acharyas have taught us how we have to worship Krishna. And definitely Radharani cooks for Krishna, that is like clearly mentioned. Right? She cooks for Krishna and she doesn't repeat an item. She can render various intimate services which may not be beyond our conception also.
Thank you, Prabhu. Prabhu, one last question from me. I'm sure others will have a few questions, but you mentioned like that Advaita Acharya is one of the reasons why Chaitanya Prabhu appeared is Advaita Acharya called him by worshipping the Sarigram with the Tulsi. And Prabhu, when he was worshipping, whom actually he prayed? He prayed directly to Krishna or he prayed to Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu himself to come in that form?
The shloka says it's he is worshipping Saligram. Let me just open that shloka. Basically, he is calling out for Krishna and Krishna descended in the form of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And because Advaita Acharya specifically called out for Krishna to spread the holy names and to transform the hearts of materialistic people. So definitely Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has taken the form of Gauranga. See this. This is in Adilila, third chapter, 99th shloka, Advaita Acharya's contemplation. If Krishna were to appear as an incarnation, he himself could preach devotion by his personal example. So it's very clear indication that Advaita Acharya is worshipping Krishna only. Apane Sri Krishna Yati Karena Avatar. Apane Achari Bhakti Karena Prachar. So the shloka says, Apane Sri Krishna Yati Karena Avatar. If Krishna descends as an avatar, and in that avatar, what he has to do? Advaita Acharya clearly mentions that Apane Achari Bhakti Karena Prachar. That Krishna in this avatar in Kali Yuga should perform bhakti and propagate bhakti also. So he is praying to Krishna and he is also desiring that Krishna has to teach us devotional service by personal practice. Thus Lord Chaitanya's incarnation is also included in that. So we can safely feel that Advaita Acharya must be aware that Krishna is going to descend as Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu also. Advaita Acharya is an eternal associate of the Lord. In which form he worshipped? Specifically this form as Saligram Shila. He was praying to Krishna. Nama Vinu Kalikali Yuga Dharma, Dharma Nahi Aya. So Yuga Dharma, to establish Yuga Dharma, Krishna has to descend. That's in the form of Lord Chaitanya. It doesn't matter also whom is he worshipping, Krishna and Gauranga. Both are same. Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Prabhu. Prabhu, one question from the participants, audience is, nowadays, many of us were reading Chaitanya Charitamrita how important is Chaitanya Bhagavat? Is that we should read Chaitanya Bhagavat or Chaitanya Charitamrita is enough? Because Chaitanya Raja Goswami said that some of the pastimes which were, he don't want to duplicate, which were already given by the previous Acharya. So he has given only a few of them or some of them. So is it important for us to read Chaitanya Bhagavat also?
Now it's individual's choice according to whatever time they have. Point is, Chaitanya Bhagavat is also bona fide scripture which is very vividly appreciated and glorified by Kaviraj Goswami in Chaitanya Charitamrita. He says that Vrindavan Das Thakur, who has written this Chaitanya Bhagavat, is the real Vyasadeva of Chaitanya Leela. Vyasadeva wrote Krishna Leela and Vrindavan Das Thakur wrote Gaura Leela, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's Leela. He is the real Vyasadeva. I am just chewing on the remnants that he has left. And I am only elaborating on what he has not elaborated in Chaitanya Bhagavat, that too at the request and orders of so many Vaishnavas. And our Prabhupada has given Chaitanya Charitamrita, his translation, his commentaries there, his whatever meanings are there. There's, we may first read Chaitanya Charitamrita, at least I did like that. And if one has the bandwidth, time and interest, definitely one can also read Chaitanya Bhagavat. It's not that it is, whether it is important to read or not. I mean, it's definitely Lord Chaitanya's Leela. Is definitely Gaudiya Vaishnavas can read Chaitanya Bhagavat. And I have heard a lot of lectures from His Holiness Radhana Swami Maharaj, which are based on Chaitanya Bhagavat and Chaitanya Charitamrita combined. Because certain leelas are not elaborated in Chaitanya Charitamrita. Leelas of, say, Mahaprakash Leela is not so elaborate in Chaitanya Charitamrita. And Jagai Madai deliverance is also not elaborate in Chaitanya Charitamrita. So like that. Chandkaji one is very elaborate here. And Sridhar Kulavich has interactions with Lord Chaitanya. They are also not very elaborate. So there's, we get full information about Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu from Chaitanya Mangal and Chaitanya Bhagavat and Chaitanya Charitamrita. So because Prabhupada has translated Chaitanya Charitamrita first, devotees may prefer to read Chaitanya Charitamrita first along with Prabhupada's commentary. But definitely other two books also can be read, should be read. In fact, if you want to know more about Lord Chaitanya, or at least they can be heard from experienced devotees who have studied them. But before they even coming to Chaitanya Charitamrita, we should nicely read Bhagavad Gita and Bhagavatam also.
Thank you.
Parallelly also. But yeah. Bhagavad Gita is like basics, ABCD.
Yes, very true. Prabhu, we have a few more devotees raise their hands to ask questions directly. Birkishan Prabhu, can ask your question.
Hare Krishna Prabhu. It was really nectarian to hear you. We went there last year. We heard from you from the Govardhan Eco Village. So my question is, Krishna is the object of love. Radharani is Ashray of love. And we know Nityananda Prabhu and Guru, with their mercy, we can have the Braja Prem. So can you relate, Prabhu, how Nityananda Prabhu helps to get that Braja Prem or to get the, Ashray or object of love?
Nityananda Prabhu is representing the Guru Tattva. He is like the spiritual master. Now you see right in the beginning of Chaitanya Charitamrita, in the first shloka only, Kaviraj Goswami gives the six features of absolute truth. Vande Guru Isha Bhakta Nisham Isha Avatarakan Tat Prakasham Satat Shakti Krishna Chaitanya Samyakam. Vande Guru means Diksha Guru and Siksha Guru. We have to offer obeisances to gurus also. Then Isha Bhaktan, devotees. Isham, the Supreme Lord Himself. Isha Avatarakan, means the incarnations of the Lord. That is basically Advaita Charya. Tat Prakasham, Prakasha is Nityananda Prabhu. Tat Shaktihi, means potency, which is Gadadhar Pandit. So offering obeisances to all the six features. Or five features. The 14th sloka says that Pancha Tattvatmakam Krishnam Bhakta Rupa Swarupakam Bhakta Avataram Bhaktakhyam Namami Bhakta Shaktikam. So Bhakta Rupa is Lord Chaitanya and Bhakta Avatara is our Advaita Charya. Pancha Tattvatmakam Krishnam Bhakta Rupa Swarupakam. Swarupa Eka is Nityananda Prabhu and Bhakta Avatara is Advaita Charya. and Bhakta Shakti is Gadadhar Pandit, and Bhakti Bhakta is our Srivast Thakur. So like that, this all Panchatattvas are there. They are actually features of Krishna, features of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and in all these features, Nityananda Prabhu is representing the Prakasha Tattva, and he is also representing the source of Guru Tattva. So without Guru, one cannot approach Krishna. And the Gurus are of two types, Diksha Guru and Siksha Guru. And in the first chapter, they are very elaborately described. We may not go into so many technical details. But the point here is, Nityananda Prabhu is Guru Tattva, and Guru, without Guru, one cannot actually approach Krishna. And Guru's role is very much there in upgrading the disciples' understanding and realization towards Krishna. So it's very much there. And definitely, most people actually may not get Guru's direct association in this setup, but definitely we can have the association of Guru through his Vani. Actually, in Kali Yuga, we have more access to Gurus than in the previous ages. In the previous ages, Gurus come and then initiate their disciples, and then Guru go for a tour. Madhvacharya may go for a tour. He may go to North India, and after 2-3 years, he may manifest. The disciple who's initiated somewhere in some corner of South India may not be able to understand the whereabouts of Guru only. But in our case, we can always be in touch with Guru through Vani. We have recordings, Aniskon Desiratory, and wherever Guru is giving live class, we can always connect and then hear from Guru, and we have association of other Guru's representatives, the senior disciples of Guru also. So that way, without Guru or without the representatives of Guru, without the Vaishnava Sangha, we cannot actually come closer to Krishna and develop a love for Krishna. Does it make sense, Prabhu?
Yes, Prabhu. Thank you. Thank you, Prabhu.
Hari Hari.
Thank you, Prabhu. Prabhu, a few more devotees are there. Radharani Mataji would like to ask a question to Prabhu.
Yes, Prabhu, thank you. Prabhuji, please accept my humble obeisances. So grateful that we could hear you live, because I have been following your lectures on YouTube continuously. Thank you so much. Prabhu, I just had a question. In Karnataka, we have Purandara Dasa and Kanaka Dasa, who have written several songs about how Yuga Avatara, Kali Yuga, Nama Avatara Prachar. So they have written, how do we connect these two great bhaktas to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, whether they were in the same age or where they learnt from? Can you just throw some light on it, Prabhu?
There are some scriptures, just like Kali Santarana Panishakti is there. In that, Kali Kalmashanasanam is this Hare Krishna Mahamantra that is mentioned there. So now some of these great exalted devotees in various parts of, especially India, they are well versed in some of these scriptures, and they know what is the Yuga Dharma of Kali Yuga, and in essence, they know our philosophy and the importance of holy name, especially in this Kali Yuga. But point is, they are in certain sampradayas, and we are following this Gaudiya Vaishnava lineage. And sometimes we may not have complete understanding of their individual practices and their sadhana, and where did they learn from, and historically where do they stand, at what, in what era they have manifested. I don't know much. And they point is, there could be some kind of written philosophical differences, or there could be some kind of differences in practices and all. But we always respect other Vaishnavas, and we do not expect respect from others, and we do not undermine them or minimize their position or insult them or feel proud that we are great. One beautiful shloka comes in the fourth canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. Ahimsaya paramaham sacharyaya smritya mukunda charitagriya sidhuna yamair akamair niyamais chapya nindaya nirihaya dvandvati tikshaya cha. I'll not elaborate on this full shloka, but this one point, anindaya. Aninda means not criticizing. So Prabhupada gives a nice purport on this beautiful word, Anindaya. A devotee should not unnecessarily criticize other bona fide sampradayas. Okay. One should not, out of one's pride or vanity, one should not minimize the position of other people or insult or criticize. So now we respect them for what they are, but we follow what our acharyas have directly given us, our regimen. We may not completely know, at least I don't know the full details of their practices, their understanding, their realization, their specific way of worshipping of God, their sadhana and all that. But if their understanding is also matching with our what scriptures are teaching, that's amazing. That's wonderful. We worship them, we respect them. When we go there, we take darshan in their temples. We go to Udupi and take their darshan. Take Udupi Krishna's darshan. We go to South India, we take Balaji darshan, Srirangam darshan and Rameshwaram. So like that. So we respect them for what they represent. We respect for what they are. They also respect. But there could be some slight differences in our specific practices. So that's fine. That's all right. So this is my little understanding. I don't know much about the two great personalities that you have quoted in Karnataka. Definitely, Purandar Das I have heard, but I don't know many details. I know very Annamacharya, I know, in South India to some degree. And I am aware of his kirtans also. But many of them, whatever I have heard, are quite matching our philosophy also. Because I'm coming from Andhra. But I don't know much more. I don't know the details of these great souls so much. But they are also doing great. They are also trying to worship Krishna. We respect them for what they are. Does it make sense, Mataji?
Yes, Prabhu. Thank you, Prabhu.
Thank you, Prabhu. Dayanidhi Dinesh Prabhu.
Yes, Prabhu. Hare Krishna, Prabhu. Thank you for your lecture in class today. Please ask my humble obeisance, Prabhuji. Prabhuji, as we have seen, you mentioned that desire, that gopis have the desire to serve Krishna always. But what made them to be have a husband also, like in the like Vastaharan and all these things we see? So how we can understand these things, Prabhuji? Please can you highlight?
During the Brahma Mohana Leela, Krishna expanded himself into so many gopas. And during that time, many of these younger gopis are married to these gopas. Means they are married to Krishna only. But Krishna was not in his form. He is in the form of his friend. Like that. So, acharyas say that all these gopis are actually wives of Krishna. And later, these other gopas came and replaced Krishna in their forms. So that way, gopis are ultimately consorts of Krishna. They are the Swarupa Shaktis of Krishna. When they are desiring Krishna's association, when the gopis are desiring to render service to Krishna, it is basically their natural constitutional position. Jivera Swarupa Hai Krishnera Nityadas. Every jiva is an eternal servant of Krishna. And of course, gopis are not like common jivas. Gopis are Swarupa Shaktis, as we discussed here. So, gopis are the expansions of Srimati Radharani, and Srimati Radharani is the personification of Mahabhava. Mahabhava is the essence of Bhava. Bhava is the essence of Prema. Prema is the essence of this Haladini potency, and Haladini potency is the confidential part of Krishna's spiritual energy. Thus, all the gopis, although apparently in their manifest pastimes, they may be seen as wives of different gopas, but they are actually personal expansions of Krishna. They are personal expansions of Krishna's pleasure potency. That is their eternal concerns of Krishna. There's nothing to wonder there. So when they are desiring Krishna, that is their natural attraction towards Krishna. So the gopis are saying in the Venu Gita that the deer, the doe, the buck, and the devi goddesses, the rivers, the birds, the trees, all of them are getting attracted to Krishna. And if we are also getting attracted to Krishna, why our elders are stopping us? Why our elders should not stop us? Because it is Krishna is the object of their eyes also. It's not that Krishna is the object of our eyes only. We are loving Krishna so much, we are attracted to Krishna. They are also supposed to be attracted to Krishna only, because Krishna is the most attractive person. So another thing, another perspective in this is, we can appreciate Gopi's specific attraction towards Krishna because they are manifesting themselves as wives of other people, sisters of other people, or daughters of other people, and they're getting attracted to Krishna. So they have broken these social customs and social bondage and other Vedic restrictions of mixing between boys and girls. Pati sutanvaya bhratrubandhava gativilanghyate achyutagatah gativirastavo udhita mohitah kitava yoshitah kastyajanish. So they have given up their patis, husbands, suta, sons, bhratru, brothers, bandhava, all relatives. Gativirastavo udhita mohitah, being attracted to Krishna's flute. They just came, leaving everything, all their activities and all their relationships. They just gave up and they came in the middle of the night to render service to Krishna, to please Krishna, to dance with Krishna. And kitava yoshitaha kastya jannishi. And Krishna says, you go back. It's not proper for you to come like this in the middle of the night. And they say that, Krishna, you're a cheater. You are a cheater. How can you tell us to go back when we gave up everything? So now we can specifically appreciate the mood of gopis in all the pastimes described in 10th canto. Because if they are officially married to Krishna like the queens of Dwaraka, they didn't have to break the bonds of social customs to associate with Krishna. Even the bondage of social customs also were not a restriction for them to express their love and emotion towards Krishna. Thus, we can understand their glory more when they're doing this. Instead of getting surprised, how can they do like this? Means when we are getting surprised that they are breaking social customs, we are giving more importance to social customs than love of God. Love of God is always greater than any of these social customs which are pertaining to this material creation. If one goes to the Swargaloka, the customs are a little different. In Bhuloka, the customs are a little different. But the customs are like time specific and geographical location specific. But Krishna Prema is eternal. So all these external restrictions are not a matter to the gopis. They can just go to Krishna. Pati sudhanvayat bhratrubandhavat ativilanghyati achyutagata. Achyuta is calling us with his flute. So let us go. So unless they have taken such a bold step of giving up everything and coming in front of Krishna to serve him, we could not have appreciated their glory so much. Wedded love, madhurya rasa, in Swakiya is understood. Oh, Krishna has so many wives, people may not have much problem. Some people have problem with that also. How come Krishna has 16,108 wives? Why only one? Why not one? Ram is better than Krishna. Ram has only one wife. He did not marry second wife. So like that, people may point out. But ultimately, it's wedded love. He had official marriage ties with them. But even without those official marriage ties, still the gopis are loving Krishna, means their love for Krishna is much more. So that paramour love is superior. Parakeya rasa is superior to Swakiya rasa, because even the social customs also cannot stop a devotee to go and render service to Krishna. So that is the glory of, the very reason for which we wonder or we get surprised, or sometimes we could get annoyed or confused about gopis' love for Krishna, that very reason is actually cause of their glory. So Acharya is very beautifully revealed. We can discuss more. Does it satisfy Prabhu to some degree at least?
Yes, Prabhuji. Thank you so much, Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. Please accept our humble obeisances, Prabhuji. Prabhuji, thank you so much for the wonderful, precious lecture, Prabhuji. So far, we are following you, YouTube and Vidyapita articles and all. But today, we are having you live. I couldn't able to trust my eyes, actually. So far, we are reading about the Shrutidharas in the scriptures, but we are seeing you live. We can understand how your Shrutidhara will be. Thank you so much.
I had to read it so many times to remember something.
Prabhuji, can you tell us how you came to Krishna Conscious, Prabhuji?
Oh, Mataji, it's a personal question. It's 1 o'clock also. And basically, to quickly say, when I was in college, in ISC in 2005, I was doing my master's, and some of my senior batch devotees, I was in first year, my second year batch devotees, they are connected to Krishna consciousness, they are connected to ISKCON somehow, and they were chanting in their room. And ISKCON Bangalore was quite close to me also, close to my college also. I used to go there and I used to associate with them. To be, to give you like more, the initial connection, my connection with ISKCON is, when I joined this college, in my hostel room, I have seen this Murali Krishna photo. So you saw the popular photo of Krishna, where Krishna is with some parrot. Krishna is holding a flute like this very small boy, 2-3 year old boy probably. And there are two parrots there. There's a yellow rose there. So that painting I have seen in my hostel room. Probably the student who was living in my room before I occupied it was an ISKCON devotee or not, I don't know. But he kept that beautiful picture on his table. It's a very big picture, A2 size. I was so attracted to it. I didn't know Kannada. And I didn't know Hindi also. I know only English and Telugu. So I just told him in Telugu and English also, both languages, please don't remove this picture. So I'll just finish the admission formalities and I'll come back. So please don't remove this picture. I don't know what that guy understood. When I finished all my admission formalities and I came there, and he exactly did the opposite. He removed the picture. So then I was attached to that picture. Somehow I was spontaneously attracted, and I liked that picture. So then my aunt was next to me, my mother's sister. So she told that this picture is available in ISKCON. I said, what is ISKCON? ISKCON is a Krishna temple. Then she took me that weekend to that ISKCON temple. Just for that one picture, I went to ISKCON temple, Bangalore. And when I went to that bookstall, seeing that picture, then that bookseller said that if you take Bhagavad Gita or Krishna book, this picture is free. So I took Bhagavad Gita also. It was in English. Okay, let me just take it. So I just took it. That's my first connection with ISKCON. And seeing this picture in my room, one of my classmates said that there are some people in our second year batch who are also chanting Hare Krishna. They also go to ISKCON. So should I introduce you with them? Then I said, okay, why not? Then that's how that picture connected me to my seniors also, second year batch. And I associated with them. And I attended some classes. I used to go to temple. And eventually I ended up in Chowpatty VTA. And from there, since 10, 12 years, I'm here. Yes. So basically, Murali Krishna painting brought me to ISKCON. Not Krishna consciousness yet, but at least to ISKCON, that Murali Krishna painting brought me. And definitely my seniors.
Amazing, bro. Prabhu, one last question. Pawan Prabhu, you had some question you wrote in the chat. Better if you can speak to Prabhu directly. Pawan Prabhu?
Other Sampradayas can't understand Krishna, so no, Lord Chaitanya Prabhu. I didn't get the question.
Prabhuji, I was asking other Sampradayas, can they understand Krishna because Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu hasn't come in their Sampradaya?
So everybody can understand Krishna to a certain degree. And no one can understand Krishna completely. This is the fact. Krishna also cannot understand Krishna completely. Otherwise, why he has to accept the emotions of Srimati Radharani and then try to understand his own sweetness. So everybody has an understanding of Krishna. All the bona fide Sampradaya devotees, they have an understanding of Krishna to a certain degree. But some people are more attached to the impersonal conception of Krishna. Some people are more attached to the personal conception of Krishna, but in an Aishwarya mood. And some other people are attached to the personal conception of Krishna in a sweet mood, as Vrindavan Krishna. Some people worship Vrindavan Krishna. Some people worship Krishna in Dwarka attire. Some people worship Krishna in his Narayana form, four-handed form. Some people worship Krishna in Balaji form. Some people worship Krishna in Padmanabha, Srirangam, Ranganath form. Some people worship Krishna as Ram. So everybody, all the bona fide Vaishnava Acharyas, Vaishnava Sampradaya devotees have a certain understanding of Krishna. And they are all in different flavors. And by an unbiased comparison, you can see that there is a hierarchy in these moods. So now, worshipping Krishna in Vrindavan, as he manifests himself in Vrindavan as a Gopal, as a cowherd boy, is considered the topmost according to Gaudiya Vaishnava Acharyas and according to Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu himself. So thus, he is the supreme form, that this is our understanding. But there are other devotees who are attached to other forms. We respect them also for what they are. Hanumanji is attached to Lord Ramachandra only, that's fine. Just like in Lord Chaitanya's associates also, there is Anupam, there is Murari Gupta. They both are attached to Lord Ramachandra's form only. But Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, the principle of devotion has to be taken from them. The way Murari Gupta or Hanumanji, they are attached to Lord Ramachandra, they worship Lord Ramachandra, they serve Lord Ramachandra, we also worship and serve and get attached to Krishna in a similar way. Aradhyo Bhagavan Vrajesha Tanayastad Dhamma Vrindavaram. This is what Lord Chaitanya has taught us. But there are some devotees who worship other forms of Krishna with similar intensity and attachment. They are also great. For example, there are 10 floors in a building. 10th floor is the top floor. And from top floor, you can get a better view of the surroundings. But some people are satisfied in the 5th floor. Some people are okay with the ground floor. That's fine. But as far as they are in the house protected, that's fine. As far as people are within the realm of pure devotional service to any of the forms of Krishna, that's wonderful. We appreciate them. We respect them. But by an unbiased comparison, we see that worshipping of Krishna as a cowherd boy in Vrindavan is the topmost worship. Naumidyate prabhupushe taditam varaya gunjavatam saparipichalasan mukhaya vanyasraje kavala vetra vishana venu lakshmashcharye vrutupadi pushipanda jaya. So Brahmaji glorifies Krishna's form as Gopal in Vrindavan as the topmost manifestation of the absolute truth. So we are in Brahma Sampradaya, we follow him. So that way, different devotees worship Krishna in different ways, we respect them. But we follow what our acharyas recommend to all of us.
Prajee, after explanation, I got small doubt. Like constitutional question, can it be in Brahmajyoti for a soul?
Jivera Swarup hai Krishnera Nitya Das. Das. Being a servant of Krishna is the constitutional position of every single Jiva. A Das means a servant should render service. In Brahmajyoti, there is no service. So being in Brahmajyoti is not natural for a devotee. Not natural for a soul. What is natural for a soul is rendering service to Krishna. And that service could be in different mood. Some people can serve Krishna in Sakhya Rasa, some people can serve Krishna in Dasya Rasa, some people can be in Vatsalya Rasa, some people in Madhurya Rasa, some people in Vaikuntha, some people in Goloka, some people Lord Ramachandra, that's fine. There are different gradations and varieties there. But being a servant of Krishna is the eternal constitutional position of every single soul. Merging in the impersonal existence or effulgence of the Lord with inactivity is not natural for a soul. Yes. Is it clear?
Okay. Yes, Prabhu. Thank you, Prabhu.
Thank you very much, Prabhu. Prabhu, if you have time, one last question from Girirani Mataji. With that, we can... sorry, Prabhu, we are taking too much time from you. Girirani Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. Dandat Pranam, Prabhuji. Prabhuji, it was a wonderful class. Prabhu, I have a doubt, what is the difference between the Shweta Deepa and the Goloka, and what are the activities in the Shweta Deepa eternally going on, Prabhuji?
That is a very technical question, elaborate question, probably beyond my understanding also, and beyond the scope of our time also. But Shweta Deepa is that place where we hear that Lord Kshirodaksaya Vishnu stays, and Goloka Vrindavan is where Lord Supreme Lord Krishna stays. So Krishna, both are spiritual abodes. Both are the abodes of the Supreme Lord only in his various forms. Just like the Lord has, we have an office room, we have a house. Like that, there are some Vaikuntha planets where the Lord stays in certain forms. And there is Goloka form, Goloka Vrindavan, where Krishna stays in his Gopal form, cowherd boy form. So different activities may be there. I don't know much. I never went there. At least I don't remember going there. I don't know much beyond this method.
Thank you, Prabhu.
Thank you very much, Prabhu. Once again, thank on behalf of all our members for accepting our humble request to grace us with your nectarian session. And really, we could had a wonderful darshan of Lord Gauranga through you. Thank you once again, Prabhu. It is a very rare opportunity for us to have your association. Thank you, Prabhu.
Thank you so much, Prabhu, for giving me this opportunity to associate with all of you. I'm very happy to know that there are this Chaitanya Charitamrita study groups and so many devotees are enthusiastically participating in this. Very happy. Thank you. Thank you for your association. I need your blessings for continuing my services. So please pray for me. Please give me your blessings so that I don't deviate from Krishna consciousness or becoming proud or do anything else. So please pray that I remain in ISKCON and Krishna consciousness for the rest of my life. Thank you very much.
Hare Krishna. Thank you,
Prabhu.
And
afternoon
to you.
Pancha Kalpata Rubyasya
Kripa. Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Prabhu.
Thank you, Prabhu. Hare Krishna. Thank you, Prabhu. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Thank you so much.
Hare Krishna.